We're speaking about the three angels' messages. And yet, really, the message involves more than just three. There's another angel. There's a fourth angel that comes into play with the three angels of Revelation 14, and that is the other angel found in Revelation chapter 18. And so today we want to begin studying about the Revelation 18, fourth angel. And I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 18. We'll begin in verse 1. Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1. John says, "And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory." Verse 2. "And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird." And verse 3. "For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies." Verse 4. "And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities." In verse 5. I find that this message is a message that seems to create opposite views among people. There is, depending upon your interpretation of these verses, and especially the understanding of who Babylon is, among some people a great zeal to want to give this message. And among others who may not have the correct view of Babylon, a great reluctance to want to give the message in its proper context, at least. None of the messages in the book of Revelation, I think, cause as much internal struggle and agitation as the message of Revelation 18, 1 through 5. The message, if you think about the message of the three angels, the first angel's message of Revelation 14 is to fear God, to worship Him, and to give glory to Him. The message of the second angel announces the fall of Babylon, but it actually doesn't call for any action of itself, not directly. And even the third angel's message, which speaks about the mark of the beast, and that we'll be lost if we worship the beast, or accept its mark, or its name, or its number, there's no direct command given in the third angel's message either. But now we come to this message, and oh yes, there is something new introduced here. There is a direct call, a direct appeal for action. And it's action in our relationship to what we understand Babylon to be. Now, to be able to understand this command, we have to have, I think, an understanding of what Babylon is in order to flee from her. And a few presentations back, when we were discussing the second angel's message, we presented a study on this concept of Babylon. And just to review a couple points, we noted, as is found in the book Great Controversy on page 381, the term Babylon is derived from Babel and signifies confusion. It is employed in Scripture to designate the various forms of false or apostate religion. So there's various different, multitudes in fact, of false and apostate religions, and Ellen White says that all of those can come under the wrapping of Babylon. What would some of those be? Buddhism? Shintoism? Hinduism? Islam? Roman Catholicism? Apostate Protestantism? Jehovah's Witnesses? Mormons? We could list a large group that are these various false or apostate religions. But in Revelation 17, we also saw that Babylon is representative specifically of the papal church and her daughters as the Protestants. She says, also in Great Controversy, in page 223, Ellen White says, "Those churches that cling to the doctrines and traditions of Rome and follow her worldly practices," she says, these are the ones that come under the condemnation there in Revelation 17. And so in our study of the second angel's message, we saw that Babylon, as mentioned in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8, can specifically speak about the Protestant churches that refused the light of the first angel's message. And thus Babylon can be very specific, or it can be very broad to include all false or apostate religious systems. Now the testimony of Jesus tells us that in the last work of warning the world, the second angel's message is to be repeated and joined with the third angel's message, and it is to swell in something we call the loud cry in the giving of that message. And I wanted to just share with you a statement now from the Review and Herald of December 6, 1892. There will be three parts to the statement, but it's all one large paragraph. And it begins by saying, "When Jesus began his public ministry, he cleansed the temple from its sacrilegious profanation. Among the last acts of his ministry was the second cleansing of the temple. So in the last work for the warning of the world, two distinct calls are made to the churches. The second angel's message is, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And in the loud cry, the third angel's message, a voice is heard from heaven saying," and that voice says, "Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues, for her sins have reached into heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities." We read that earlier in Revelation 18, didn't we? And notice here in this that it says that we are to come out, and it gives us the rationale on why we must come out. Because if we do not come out, it says that we will receive of her plagues, we will partake of her sins, because they have reached unto heaven. The testimony of Jesus speaks of the loud cry of the third angel's message, and it quotes it as saying, "Come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities." Now, where in the biblical text of the third angel's message does it say that? Look back to Revelation 14, 9 through 12, and tell me, where in the biblical text does it say that? And she has it in quote marks here. But of course, it doesn't say it in the actual text of the third angel, does it? It says it in the text of the fourth angel. And here we see that the testimony of Christ is taking these two messages and joining them as if they are one. Inspiration is connecting the third angel's message with the message of the angel of Revelation 18. And these messages combine and swell into what we are told is a loud cry. In early writings, page 277, we read, "The work of this angel comes in at the right time to join in the last great work of the third angel's message as it swells to a loud cry." And so the message of the fourth angel comes in and joins with the message of the third angel about the mark of the beast. And she says it swells to a loud cry. Now, when we think of the three angels' messages of Revelation, we think of these angels as being symbolic, representing humanity or human beings giving a message from heaven. Even though John in his vision may have saw what he interpreted as literal angels, we understand that these angels are symbolic of messengers giving a message. The Greek word translated in Revelation 14 is angelon, from angelos, the word for angel, and that word simply means messenger. It means messenger. Okay? But based upon this, I think that we would generally agree that the application of the fourth angel is also symbolic. However, we also have statements to consider in which Ellen White says that she saw things in heaven. And while she had visions that were symbolic, most of her visions were to be interpreted literally, and the few that were symbolic were clearly to be revealed as such. And now I want you to please notice the phraseology of the following language from early writings, page 277. I saw. How does it begin? I saw. I saw angels hurrying to and fro in heaven, descending to the earth and again ascending to heaven, preparing for the fulfillment of some important event. Then I saw another mighty angel commissioned to descend to the earth to unite his voice with the third angel and give power and force to his message. Great power and glory were imparted to the angel, and as he descended, the earth was lightened with his glory. The light which attended this angel penetrated everywhere as he cried mightily with a strong voice, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Here, and in other passages, Ellen White explains what she has seen in a sense that appears to be very literal. And so while humanity is entrusted with the messages to be given, she says God has indeed entrusted a mighty angel to help in this work. And as this mighty angel comes down, he encourages, he teaches, he inspires people to give this message, to join him as messengers, if you please, in giving this message. I want you to mark also the magnitude and the importance of the message that's to be given, these messages and their sacredness. And this is also found in the testimony for the church. The testimony of Jesus gives us this from the Testimonies for the Church, volume 6, page 406. She says, we are to throw aside our narrow, selfish plans, remembering that we have a work of the largest magnitude and highest importance. In doing this work, we are sounding the first, second, and third angels' messages and are thus being prepared for the coming of that other angel from heaven who is to lighten the earth with his glory. Did you get it? It says that this message is of the largest magnitude. It is of the highest importance. You don't get any higher or more important than that. Now let's just begin, and we're only going to begin today. We won't get probably even halfway through in the time we have that we will use, and we'll finish this next week, Lord willing. But let's begin to look at these five verses of Revelation 18. We're going to look at them step by step, verse by verse, and try to examine them and understand a little bit more about their importance, why they have the largest magnitude and the highest of importance that we can have. In Revelation 18, in verse 1 again, he says, after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. He says, after these things, and I ask you, what things? After what things? What chapters precede Revelation 18? 17? 16? What's chapter 16 in Revelation about? The seven last plagues. And chapter 17 is about the judgment of the great whore. Now, we need to remember that the plagues do not come until after probation is closed. And yet the giving of the message is to tell people to come out of Babylon so they won't be lost. So there clearly is not a chronological progression here. Do you understand what I mean? In other words, chronologically, in the events that will literally happen on this earth, Revelation 18 has to come before Revelation 16. Otherwise, no one would be saved, right? But as you look through the book of Revelation, you will see a progression of events given in prophetic structure. For instance, you have the seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3. You have the seven seals. You have the seven trumpets. And many of these sevens are repeating events from a different perspective or going back and forth chronologically. So Revelation 18 isn't chronologically fulfilling after Revelation 16 and 17, just to make sure that we get that clear. Because the message of the giving of the fourth angel has to happen before the plagues fall and before probation closes. Amen. And I believe that all the evidence tells us that the time for this message is today. Amen. It's now. And so when we realize that when John says after these things, he means that after seeing the events of the vision recorded in this time, he's not speaking again of a chronological order, a line of fulfillment. so we don't want to get tripped up by that. Now, this angel is said to come down from heaven having great power. The Greek expression is exousion megalon, and it means great authority. Exousion is from exousia, and it means power in the sense of authority. Megalon, we get our English word mega from this word, mega meaning huge. So this angel has great authority. In 1962, some of us are old enough to remember, in October of 1962, there was what we today call the Cuban Missile Crisis. And there were 13 days that this earth was teetering on whether it was going to live or not. And I was just recently listening to an interview with Daniel Ellsberg, who had worked in intelligence and security at that time. And the things that we know today that weren't even understood at that time, what would have happened if we had went into nuclear war at that time? The great odds are that none of us would be here today. In fact, it was estimated that because of the amount of nuclear fallout, what it was going to do to the atmosphere and the climate that they didn't understand at that time, that at most 1% of the population of the Earth would have survived. Think about that. But you know, when I think about that, I think about what God says when he says he has four angels holding the four winds of the earth, because there must be a little more time for the servants of God to be sealed in their foreheads. But we came so close, and things were tense. And President John Kennedy, one of his closest, most trusted aides at that time was his younger brother, Robert, Bobby Kennedy, who was the Attorney General at that time in the United States. And he was the head of what they called the XCOM committee that was dealing with this crisis they were going through. And they had been volleying back and forth with Premier Khrushchev, and they had been sending letters and counter letters and trying to come to a consensus, because it was just coming down to the place that they didn't see any way out. And so finally, President Kennedy, he told his brother Robert, to go see the Soviet ambassador, Anatoly Dobrynin. And he says, this was Saturday night, and he says, you tell them that we have to have a resolution now, because if we don't get a resolution by tomorrow morning, on Monday, we're going to war. It's just that simple. And when Robert Kennedy told this to Dobrynin, he said, I have to know. He says, does this come from the highest authority of your government? In other words, is this your message, or is your brother telling you this? And Robert Kennedy assured him it's coming from the highest authority. So Dobrynin took it back to Khrushchev, sent a teletype or whatever to Khrushchev, and got the message. And the next morning, Radio Moscow announced that the Soviets would be removing the missiles from Cuba, and war was averted. Because we sent him a message based upon the highest authority we had. But I want to tell you, friends, God has sent a message from heaven, from the highest authority. And it is at our greatest peril if we ignore that message. Can you imagine what this world, I can't imagine what would have happened in this world if Dobrynin had ignored that message of the highest authority. But yet we do it, and we do it at the peril of our eternal life. As Christians, we have in Revelation 18 a message of the highest authority, and we are not to speak these messages of ourselves. You know, I say sometimes things that appear to be very hard to people, and they wonder, why do you do that? Why do you do that? I don't do it. It's not me. The messenger should never be the one bringing the message. He is simply the one carrying the message, but he is not the originator of the message. It is to come from the highest authority. If it doesn't, we shouldn't be proclaiming it. But friends, when we proclaim the message of the fourth angel, we are not again sounding our own message, but the message from the highest authority. Now notice that the effect of the message is to lighten the earth with the glory of God. And I'd like to propose that there are two ways that this glory is manifested. In Luke chapter 2 and verse 9, we read here that during the birth of Jesus, there were shepherds in the field. And suddenly, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. This glory was one that radiated and illuminated like the lights that we have on in here. And the shepherds were lightened by that, and like me, probably, they were afraid if I'd been there. But there's another kind, and that's found in the prophet Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 14, if you'd like to turn there. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 14. And there the prophet says, "For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." Now this glory is not one of physical illumination, but rather one of God's character being revealed through humanity. And this is what Paul meant when he was writing to the Corinthian church. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, he said, "But we all with open face beholding as in a glass," what? "The glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." And then in chapter 4 and verse 6 of the same book, he says, "For God, who commanded the light to shine out darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Now, these texts don't mean that we can go to a mirror and see our faces shining or glowing or reflecting something from God. But rather, these verses are speaking of the character of Christ shining through his people. In Revelation 18, it says that the earth was lightened by the glory of God, but this glory is his character. And this is what he wants us to reveal to other people, is his character. In Revelation 18, 2, "And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird." This angel cries with what kind of a voice? A loud voice, a strong voice. He cries mightily. Friends, this is not something that we soft pedal, not something that we hide in a corner, is it? The message, Babylon is fallen. The message here we find is the message of the second angel repeated. In Spiritual Gifts, volume 1, page 194, it says, "The message of the fall of Babylon as given by the second angel is again given with," notice this, "with the addition of the corruptions which have been entering the churches since 1844. So, when the fourth angel's message goes, it is to repeat the message of the second angel with the additional corruptions that have been entering the churches since 1844. Not just simply the apostate doctrines they had at that time. You know, James White, he mentioned Sunday sacredness. He mentioned the immortality of the soul doctrine. He mentioned the Trinity doctrine as some of the wine of Babylon. Right? But the message we have has that gist, of course, but it says it is to deal with also the additional corruptions that have been entering the churches, not just churches. In 1844, the message went out that Babylon had fallen due to its rejection of the first angel's message. We mentioned it before. These people were not yet, though, tested. Remember this. They were not yet tested on the Sabbath. They weren't tested on the sanctuary, the state of the dead, or even the truth about God yet. But yet they were fallen. But they were tested upon the advancing light of the first angel's message concerning the second coming of Christ. And since that time, more light has been presented to these churches. What have they done with it? Have they rejected it or accepted it? Have they said, you know what, we want to join you in this Advent message. We want to get in with this Advent movement, and we want to propel this thing far and wide about the open, literal, visible second coming of Christ. No. You know what we hear? We hear now that Jesus is coming in some secret rapture. Friends, that wasn't taught in 1844. Do you know that? That was a very, very uncommon teaching in 1844. That didn't catch in until about the turn of the 20th century in evangelical Protestantism. This idea of a secret rapture and dispensationalism as it's taught today. Great light concerning the Sabbath. Great light on the state of the dead. great light on the sanctuary and the truth about God has come about also, though, since that time. It's been presented to these churches, and while we admit the light has not had the best presentation it's deserved, it has been, though, very clearly and sadly rejected by most. But Ellen White speaks not only of the doctrines, but she speaks about the addition of corruptions, the addition of the corruptions. The lowering of standards is appalling. You might not know it, but when John Wesley began what we today know as the Methodist Church, he wrote in his advice to the people called Methodists with regard to dress, he wrote this. He said, "Wear no gold, no pearls, or precious stones. I do not advise women to wear rings, earrings, necklaces." John Wesley. Oh, you thought that this strict dress code stuff was only Adventist. Friends, there was a time you can belong to the Methodist Church and wear a wedding ring. Did you know that? This standard concerning dress and ornaments became part of the Methodist Church manual, Doctrines and Disciplines of the Methodist Church, and it continued until at least the year 1852. And that's an important date because of the closeness of its proximity to 1844. So whenever these churches began to reject the message about 1844, the soon coming of a literal, visible Christ, they opened themselves up to delusion. They opened themselves up to a lowering of standards and an entering of corruptions that they had no idea would come. Now, we heard Brother Jean Christophe in a mission report just a little bit ago. And the part of the part we heard said that there was an elder watching this baptism that they were performing, making fun of it, making light of it, laughing. But this very elder had said that he did not believe in any sanctuary doctrine. Right? Did I hear him right? That's right. That's what he said. And I've met many people like this who say there's no sanctuary, there's no sanctuary doctrine, there's no sanctuary in heaven. Or all heaven is a sanctuary. There's no two-apartment sanctuary in heaven. You know, so many variations of lies. There's only one truth, but there's many variations of the false teachings. But when we let go of these precious, important truths, friends, it just opens us up to a floodgate of other things. And I think some of us have seen it in the last 12 years in this movement. Isn't that right? We've seen people who thought that they were holding on to the basic core fundamentals, but were just starting to change a few things, and before long, a few more things got changed, and now it has been just a Pandora's box of error flying out to the people of God. Today, and I don't want to make a hobby horse about just the standards itself, but today, friends, it's hard to see the difference between the people who profess to be God's people in the world. I remember attending a seminar at Andrews University a few years ago and had rented a room in the dormitory to stay in during this time, and I heard what sounded like rock and roll music in the dormitory. I thought, well, you know, what's going on here? Maybe someone's in their room, they got this music playing loud, but I decided to follow the music to see where it went to. It didn't go to an individual's room. It went to the auditorium and an official worship service in that dormitory. I want to tell you, friends, if the prophet were alive today, she would speak up. And if we will read her writings, she'll speak up today. It's just not the nominal churches that have fallen, but even the professed church of God. And beloved, I just think it would be wonderful if everywhere we went, people would recognize us as Seventh-day Adventist people because we are different and because we are peculiar. Not that we want to be different, not that we're trying to be someone unique, but because we follow God, and God's ways, friends, are not the ways of the world. Jesus has told us that the church and the world will be at enmity with each other, that they will never be friends with each other. Now, in Ezekiel chapter 8, we have some very specific areas in which those who profess to be God's church have fallen since 1844. God showed Ezekiel abominations that were occurring in Jerusalem. And chapter 8 of Ezekiel is therefore an enacted prophecy. It's things that were literally happening in Jerusalem in Ezekiel's time, but they were events that were prophetic then of things that would happen among God's people in the end of time. The first two abominations are bad enough, and I won't take time to discuss them today. But with each abomination, the prophet is told that he would see worse things. In Ezekiel 18, he says, "Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations that they do." Now I want you to notice a greater abomination in verse 14, Ezekiel 8:14. "Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz." Who was Tammuz? And why were the women weeping for Tammuz? Tammuz, we are told, was the illegitimate son of Semiramis, the wife of Nimrod. After Nimrod had died, Semiramis proclaimed that he left to go to become the sun god. And when she became pregnant after Nimrod's death, she made the claim that the sun rays of Nimrod had impregnated her with this divine child. And after Tammuz was born and grown to manhood, he was killed in a hunting excursion by a wild boar. 40 days of weeping or mourning were proclaimed for Tammuz. Hot buns were baked with crosses or T's for Tammuz upon them in his honor. By the way, does anything, ain't that sound familiar to you? Hot cross buns, 40 days of Lent, anything like that? Sure. It's just all come right into the Catholic religion. But this is where it comes from. It was proclaimed that Tammuz had ascended to the sun to be with his father Nimrod. And so Tammuz was a false Christ. He was a false son of God. And professed Christianity today worships Tammuz in the form of the second person of the Trinity. You may not feel that this prophecy, despite its context, has any relevance today, but please remember what Ellen White said in Selected Messages, Book 3, page 338. She says, "Each of the ancient prophets spoke less for their own time than for ours, so that their prophesying is in force for us." This is important. We understand these things. It's necessary. Now, the fourth abomination in Ezekiel, and by the way, we're told that those who participate in these abominations don't get the seal of God. And only those people who sigh and cry for the abominations get the seal of God. Amen. Does that sound like it should be important to us? Amen. I mean, it's an eternal life or death issue, friends.
That's right.
You know, this isn't whether we want popcorn or tuna tonight for Vesper meal. Okay? Verse 16 of Ezekiel 8, "And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the east." Here are men who, it says, are between the porch and the altar, and instead of, as Joel says, they should be weeping between the porch and the altar, here we find them worshiping with their backs to the sanctuary, their faces to the east, worshiping the sun. These leaders in apostasy have turned their backs on our sanctuary message, a message that we should have cherished, a message that is sacred, and they've not been upholding those truths. And we have a responsibility to uphold these truths, Amen. To teach these truths. And in fact, there's a statement I like from the Spirit of Prophecy. It's in the Home Missionary of July 1, 1897. She says, "The Lord has made his people the repository of sacred truth." Let me just stop there. When she says it's a repository of sacred truth, does that mean it's something we can just take and cast away or do something we don't want with? You know, you go to the bank and you rent a safety deposit box, for example. And you do that because you want to keep very important documents or maybe possessions in that box. It's a secure way to keep them. But God wanted his people to be the repository, a place to hold these sacred truths, to not let go of them, to not defile them. She says, upon every individual, and that's every one of us in this sanctuary, everyone who hears my voice, everyone who believes this message, upon every individual who has had the light of present truth devolves the duty of developing that truth into a higher scale than it has hitherto been done. She doesn't say that we replace the truth. She doesn't say we come up with a new truth, but we take that truth and we raise it to a higher scale than hitherto it has been done. But if you look at the fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I'm just going to make mention of one right now, fundamental belief number 24, because it's in connection with this verse in Ezekiel 8:16 that we read. This is under the title, Christ's Ministry in the Heavenly Sanctuary. You're going to find that this statement has phraseology right out of the apostate book, Questions on Doctrine. Notice what it says. It says, there is a sanctuary in heaven. Oh, wait. Let's just be thankful. We believe in a sanctuary doctrine. There is a sanctuary in heaven. The true tabernacle, which the Lord set up and not man. Of course, it doesn't say if it's a one apartment, two apartment, or what it is, but it says we believe in it. In it, Christ ministers on our behalf. We believe Christ ministers in the sanctuary, don't we? I mean, it's pretty good so far. In it, Christ ministers on our behalf, making available to believers the benefits of his atoning sacrifice offered once for all on the cross. And friends, if you don't get it, I can understand, because the language is so close to the genuine. But I want you to notice the parallel thought in the book Questions on Doctrine. This is the 1957 edition. When therefore one hears an Adventist say that Christ is making atonement now, wait a minute, here he's doing something for us, right? Back here in the statement says he's doing something for us. When therefore one hears an Adventist say that Christ is making atonement now, it should be understood that we mean simply that Christ is now making application of the benefits of the sacrificial atonement he made on the cross. Does that sound like this and in places virtually word for word? Like the fundamental. It says he's now making application of the benefits of the atonement he made on the cross. So the idea is that everything that Jesus did and accomplished for us was done on the cross, and now he only makes application of that in heaven. And that is the standard teaching in Adventism today. It's actually written into our fundamental belief. So now we read this interesting statement, and also from Questions on Doctrine. How glorious is the thought that the King who occupies the throne is also our representative at the court of heaven. This becomes all the more meaningful when we realize that Jesus, our surety, entered the holy places and appeared in the presence of God for us, but it was not with the hope of obtaining something for us at that time or at some future time. No, he had already obtained it for us on the cross. And that emphasis is in the original. What they're saying is that there is not a final atonement. There's not a dual atonement. There's not an atonement of the cross and an atonement in the sanctuary in heaven. There's one atonement, and Jesus simply applies that atonement, and that atonement on the cross is an atonement of justification. And there's no atonement of sanctuary, which is the atonement of sanctification. Justification only, no sanctification. And that's the whole concept. But friends, that doesn't jive compared to this statement in early writings. As the priest entered the most holy once a year to cleanse the earthly sanctuary, so Jesus entered the most holy of the heavenly at the end of the 2300 days of Daniel 8 in 1844 to make a final atonement for all who could be benefited by his mediation and thus to cleanse the sanctuary. She does not say that he went in to apply the benefits of an atonement already made somewhere else. She says he goes in to make the final atonement. And that is a very, very different teaching. Mainline Adventism has turned its back on the true Christ, on the sanctuary, and Ezekiel goes on to say that the final rejection involves the worship of the Son. And if you examine these abominations, you will find out that they are in fast fulfillment. And the fulfillment of this last one is coming rapidly. It's not uncommon to find Sunday sunrise Easter services, ecumenical services on Sunday, becoming more and more frequent in Adventist churches. And friends, it's only logical for this to happen because if we're going to worship the God of Babylon, if we're going to worship the God of Babylon, and who's the God of Babylon? Trinity, the Trinity doctrine. Then we should worship on the day dedicated to the Trinity. And Catholicism and Protestantism will tell you that the day dedicated to the worship of the Trinity is Sunday. And so the pressure is going to be brought in. Look, we all worship the same God. We're all liking this. We should worship Him together on the same day. And according to the prophecy of Ezekiel, it's going to happen. Those who are ringleaders in this apostasy, who do not stand for the truth, will submit and enter into Sunday worship. There is celebration, Pentecostal-style worship in Adventism now. And you know, that's in Revelation 13. You see prophecy about this false Pentecostal movement. And the educational work that we have failed to do in the work, the medical work that we have failed to do, the literature fails to give that trumpet the certain sound. And yet, interestingly, the spirit of prophecy has declared that in a large degree through our publishing houses is to be accomplished the work of that other angel who comes down from heaven with great power and who lightens the earth with his glory. What's she speaking about here?
18.
The message of Revelation 18, the message about the fall of Babylon, the message to come out of Babylon. And she says that that is going to be accomplished to a great degree by the work of who? Our publishing houses. Through the printed page. And I think we could allow today, with the advance of technology and process, we could say through the internet, through the electronic medium as well. But the fact is, friends, when you try to find it, Just try to find it. Do you realize that in the current statement of belief of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, there's no statement on the importance of prophecy? Studying these chains of prophecy to understand our time and place. There's nothing in the statements of belief in the Seventh-day Adventist Church today that speak about 1844. There is no statement in the Seventh-day Adventist Church today, fundamentals, about the man of sin being the papacy, who is thought to change times and laws and deceive all Christendom. You say, well, why is that such an issue, Alan? Well, it's such an issue because, friends, when this church was founded, and for its first 100-some years, there were statements and beliefs about those very things, and they are no longer in your fundamentals, and they've been missing for a good long time since about the time questions on doctrine came on the scene. And so, the very work of giving the message in print has been replaced with books, many of which only teach the doctrines of Babylon, and they do not awaken the lightest spiritual sleeper there is. And when we see the additional corruptions which have been entering the churches since 1844, beloved, we have a duty to speak up. Because, again, only those who sigh and cry for the abominations that are done therein will receive the seal of God. And everyone, friends, everyone who goes along with these abominations, whether they're doing it intellectually, whether they're doing it just because it's part of the crowd, you know, the herd mentality, they don't want to create waves or whatever, they're not going to get the seal of God. Now, I want to tell you, it would be a lot nicer and a lot easier for me if I could just say, you know what, all we have to do is just say I love Jesus and smile a lot and we're all going to go to heaven together. Make my job a lot easier. And you'd probably like me a lot better. But we'd all be lost together too. And my soul was bought with the same precious blood your soul was bought with. And brothers and sisters, if I'm preaching to you error, if I'm preaching to you hogwash, as we say here in West Virginia, you should let me know. But you show me from the testimonies, you show me from the scriptures where what I've said today is wrong. And I can assure you, it's truth. And we need to take this truth and develop it to a higher plane than hitherto it's been given to us. And in the second part of this study, we're going to go through the rest of verse 2 into verses 3, 4, and 5 of Revelation 18, and we're going to see how this applies even more. And may God bless you lots and lots. Mm-hmm.